For a while now, I've been wanting to figure out what people eat in Alush, but trying to cover it all in one video would be biting off more than I can chew. So I figured it would make sense to start with what the Alush consider the most important, the staples that the rest of their diet is built around. Many cuisines in our world are centered on specific foods, especially in agricultural societies. These foods are things like bread, rice, or potatoes. They tend to be high in energy, specifically carbohydrates, easy to store, available for much of the year, and versatile. They're also deeply ingrained in culture, showing up in things like symbols of identity and religious practices. Even if not everyone can eat them all the time, they're like that culture's platonic ideal of what food is. So, in early Mesopotamian writing, the word for eat is written with the sign for mouth and the sign for bread, and in several Chinese languages, the word for rice can also just mean food. In Mayan culture, maize was central to both food and religion. In Mayan stories, humans were created from maize dough, and drinks and foods made of maize were regularly offered to gods. In East Africa, stews are served on top of a large flatbread called injera. Because everyone eats the same piece of injera, it's a symbol of unity. Women are judged on their ability to make good injera, and babies are sometimes rolled in it for good luck. For much of northwestern Europe, that staple is bread, specifically leavened wheat bread. That's why the primary income earner of a household is called the breadwinner. And the words lord and lady come from Old English words meaning loaf keeper and loaf kneader. These foods don't necessarily have to be crops. They can also be animal products. For example, Maasai staples are meat, blood, and dairy. But I'm going to focus on plants here. So I decided to have a look at the kinds of crops that diets tend to be based around, and what kinds of environment they show up in. There are five main categories: fruits, nuts, grains, legumes, and tubers. Starchy fruits, like plantain, jackfruit, and breadfruit, are common as staples in humid tropical areas. It takes a lot of sunlight and water to produce fruit large and energy dense enough to be good staple foods. Plus, tropical areas tend to have a longer growing season, so fruit is available for longer periods. In temperate climates, it's a lot harder to have fruits as staples, because they aren't as energy dense and they're not around for long enough. Sugary fruits, like figs and dates, seem more common in arid tropical areas. While some are considered staples, because they're so sweet, they aren't often considered an essential part of meals. Then there are nuts. Nuts are hard, heavy seeds that are found basically wherever trees are. They tend to be larger and fattier in areas where it's most advantageous to grow quickly. In dark forests, for example, where it will need to grow tall to access any light, and arid areas, where it will need a wide root system to access as much water as possible. Because they tend to be a big investment for the plant, they'll invest in defences so they don't get eaten, like bitter chemicals or hard shells. Nuts aren't so common as staples these days because they're not super easy to cultivate in large quantities. But historically, nuts have been really important, acorns and chestnuts in particular. Next up, grains. Grains are the small, dry seeds of grasses. Or at least in the wild, they're small and dry. Humans have kind of messed with that. Grasses often live in areas with unpredictable weather, and having dry seeds means they can wait a long time for good conditions before they start growing. And they don't need to be that big, because they tend to grow in areas with lots of light. They don't need that much energy stored in order to survive. That means they have kind of a different size pattern than nuts. In drier areas, you get smaller seeded grasses like millet and sorghum, because they can't afford to make larger seeds. In wetter areas, you find grasses with larger seeds, like wheat and rice. They're getting more energy coming in, so they might as well spend it on helping out their seeds, since grasses usually only last a year themselves. That short lifespan also means they're pretty easy for humans to domesticate, and probably contributed to grains being the most eaten crops on Earth. Grains are often associated with legumes, because they make a great pair. Grains remove nitrogen from the soil, while legumes have nitrogen-fixing bacteria in their roots that replenish it. Legumes have essential nutrients that grains don't, and vice versa. So real-life cuisines often have pairings like beans and maize, lentils and rice, or chickpeas and farro. And in some, legumes get kind of a bad reputation. In a society where animal products are highly valued, legumes might drop out of richer diets entirely. Because if you're getting your protein and nutrients from meat, there's no need to eat peas, and so they get associated with poverty. But this doesn't seem to have happened in societies with less prestige attached to animal products. Lastly, there are tubers, corms, and roots, like potatoes, sweet potatoes, and yams, which are basically underground nutrient storage facilities. There are a few reasons plants might have storage organs full of nutrients. If they're in an area with lots of seasonal variation, whether that's hot and cold or wet and dry, they can store energy all through one growing season, grow dormant for a while, and then use the stored energy to regrow at the start of the next season. Being underground can protect them from extreme temperatures too, and from animals that want to eat them. Because they don't have to hold themselves up, they can grow to much larger sizes than seeds. In arid areas, tubers grow deep under the ground as an adaptation to drought, so they can reach the water table. There's a theory that large savanna tubers helped with hominid brain development, because we needed to develop tools to dig for them. And in wetlands, large roots are an adaptation to store gaseous oxygen during periods of waterlogging, which I think is why some of these roots are pretty crunchy, and why they're sometimes less energy dense. They need to have a lot of empty space for the oxygen, and thick walls to hold it in. Okay, let's apply this to Illush. I'm going to mostly use real plants, with a sprinkling of invented ones, because I like real plants, and it would be fun to be able to cook Illush food someday. Since Illush has a variety of ecosystems, there are going to be some regional differences. For simplicity's sake, I'm going to split it up into three regions: wetlands, alluvial plain, and outer. In the wetlands, there are crunchy tubers, like water chestnuts and cattail rhizomes. There's also a small tuber called minnow, which has a little caffeine in to prevent it from rotting in waterlogged soil. Wetland grains, similar to rice, are adapted to hold water well without disintegrating, so they can be dispersed by the river. On the alluvial plain, it's a bit drier. This area is dominated by grasses, like wheat and barley, with rice in the wettest regions and millet in the driest. They're interspersed with legumes. Some of these are recognisable from our world, like chickpeas, lentils, lupins, and mung beans. When those ripen, their pods split open and disperse the seeds. But Illush also has a kind of legume that builds up pressure as it ripens, so that when it's touched, the seed pod explodes and the seeds shoot away. These are difficult to harvest when ripe for obvious reasons, so people eat them while they're immature and green. There are also scattered trees and some pockets of woodland, providing chestnuts, acorns, and figs. In the outer regions, where far fewer people live, there are woodlands, scrublands, and arid grasslands. The most available staples here are acorns and chestnuts, accompanied by figs, small grains like millet, and the pseudo-cereal buckwheat. In the very driest areas, there are pines called Dal Sakang, which grow tall to avoid being damaged by fires, and cover large, energy-rich seeds in coats that only open in extreme heat. There are tubers deep under the ground here to access the water table and avoid extreme temperatures, which could make a good staple in theory, but this area is inhabited mostly by wayfinder people, who have a cultural distaste for underground vegetables. That's not every plant that exists in Illush, of course, but they're what people are most likely to build meals around, though some of them aren't really edible right now. I guess we'll have to cook them next video.